Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Know to Grow podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Ivan Khan, and I'll be breaking down topics around education, growth, and culture with the intention to help your own growth journeys. For those not familiar with our hosting organization, Constatorial, I serve as the CEO, and we serve kids K through 12 in supplemental education centers throughout New York City. One of the unique privileges of our work is the opportunity to really know the various communities that our team serves and discover the various challenges that students face within themselves, their families, and overall community systems. Today, I'm joined by a very, very special guest, New York State Senator Jamaal Bailey. State Senator Jamaal Bailey represents New York's 36th State Senate District, which covers the Bronx neighborhoods of Norwood, Bedford Park, Williams Bridge, Co-op City, Wakefield, and Baychester, and the Westchester city of Mount Vernon. Senator Bailey was elected to the State Senate in November 2016 after serving as Community Relations Director to Assemblymember Carl Heastie. He's also a district leader in the 83rd Assembly District for 6 years. He's a member of the Williams Bridge branch of the NAACP, and most importantly, he's a mentor to a young man in Butler United Methodist Church, where he remains an active member. Above all, Senator Bailey is a dedicated family man who lives with his wife, Giamara, and their two young daughters in Baychester, where he routinely where he continues to live out the advice of his family that one can only get out of their community what they put into it. So, Senator Bailey, thank you so much for agreeing to be on our pod.
Thank you.
Go way back 25 years since we graduated high school a few years apart, 1 year apart, actually. But I got to start with, you know, this episode's about fatherhood, but I got to start with the first question on my mind. What was it like growing up a Met fan in the Bronx in our era? Because, you know, if you're from the Bronx, people already assume Yankees. I'm a Met fan, but I'm a guy from Queens. So tell us a little about that.
Well, one, welcome to the 36th Chamber, right? 36th Senatorial District, the 36th Chamber. Thank you for coming all the way uptown. I appreciate it, Dr. Khan. Good to see you, man. Happy to, as you said, we go way back. And it's been a while since Bronx Science, but being a Bronx Met fan has been something that is it's been challenging at times, right?
Of course.
I became a Met fan because of Dwight Gooden and Daryl Strawberry.
Yep.
And much like in education, when you see representation,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of, you can envision something, right? Oh. I saw Doc and Daryl. Mm-hmm. I saw younger African-American players who were at the top of their game. And I was like, you know what? This is the team that I want to root for. And I happen to like orange and blue. It kind of works out. I'm a Knicks fan too, as you know. So I've just been riding with the Mets ever since, and it's been a bumpy ride. But
oh yeah,
three back with 10 games to go. I can't ask for anything better.
Amazing, amazing. And Mr. Bailey Sr., he wasn't a Mets fan, right? He's always been a Yankee fan.
No, my dad is a Yankee fan. Yeah, he's actually a hybrid Dodger fan / Yankee fan. He's a Dodger fan because my grandfather was a Dodger fan because of Jackie Robinson.
Of course.
But his rooting interest really is with the Yankees. And one of the things about fatherhood that my dad taught me and being a fan of the Mets teaches you that you have to allow your children to be who they are. My dad never tried to make me a Met fan mm-hmm. or a Net fan, which is – or because he's a Net fan and a Yankee fan. He never tried to push me in the direction.
God.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my God. It's crazy. But my dad allowed me to be who I am, and I'm eternally grateful for it.
Amazing, amazing. So hopefully we prevent the same mistakes. I'm a father to two young kids. We got a lot of New York City culture up for grabs with the Nets versus Knicks, but we'll touch on that later. Tell us about fatherhood. You have two girls, 5 and 3, an incredible queen in your household to lead the whole show. Tell us about your family.
I am incredibly blessed. My wife, Jamara, she is an attorney by day, magician by night.
Mm-hmm.
She's able to manage the household quite well. Working full time, you know, at her full time attorney,
full time double
full time mom
mm-hmm.
to two amazing young girls. My oldest, Giada, she's 5, just started kindergarten this mm-hmm. year, and you know, I do drop off, and a piece of my heart goes with her every single day when I drop her off, and
yeah.
when I pick her up as well every day. You know, I'm just I'm overjoyed about fatherhood, man. And my youngest, Karina, she's the spitfire, the youngest child. She loves to laugh. Mm-hmm. She has lots of fun and very socially aware. You know, they say the youngest child follows in the footsteps, and they walk first because they're following after that after their older sibling. So, you know, I am incredibly blessed to have two incredibly precocious, intelligent, and boisterous young women. And I encourage my young women to speak up and, you know, don't be silenced by our society.
Hashtag future is female. I follow you on your social media platforms and I'm so proud to see fellow dads push female empowerment from a young age. So your older one, she just went to the first day of school. And one of the reasons why we wanted to sit with you is because the Senate session, you know, your district is about three and a half hours away. How will your everyday parenting duties change and shift when you have to be in Albany half the week? And if you want to let our listeners know a little bit what life is like for parents in the Senate.
So it's tough, Ivan. It's incredibly tough. Generally what happens during legislative session is this. The legislative session, when we're in session, we'll start on Monday. We generally go into session around 3 o'clock, but we'll have meetings before that. So I don't like to rush to all, but I don't like to rush right into a meeting, but I also don't want to lose any time. Mm-hmm. Some members go up Sunday night because it is more convenient. I always go up early Monday morning.
Okay.
And that requires me getting up at around 5 or 6 in the morning and leaving to go up there, hopefully get up there by 9 or 9:30 or so I can start the day and starting to have meetings. During that time when we're in session, it's incredibly difficult. So I can imagine that this year is going to be much more difficult because my oldest is school age now, mm-hmm. and that she is a part of, she's a part of the PS-153 family.
Yeah.
And last year in pre-K, pre-K was a little easier because the pre-K that my oldest went to was in my wife's workplace.
Childcare programs, you promote them, they've worked out for you?
I think they're amazing. I think they worked out well. It's one commute, easy drop off, an easy pickup. You're in the same place. Now we're going to really have to espouse that it truly takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah.
And my mother-in-law, my father-in-law, my parents, my stepmother, everybody's all hands in. And we're looking forward to we're looking forward to her succeeding in kindergarten, but making sure that family structure is intact. So it's tough, man. You spend a lot of time away from home, in Albany, away from your children, and FaceTime, as you know, it's
so you gotta rely on the technology just to get by until that Thursday, Friday. You guys get to come back, the senators and assembly folks.
Well, it depends on that session week. Okay. So, for example, in January and years past, we've only been up there for a day or two.
Okay.
I think the session calendar may change, but there are days that weeks in March where I am pretty much home only on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Yeah.
And I go back up. On Monday. My first year in the Senate, we were actually up in Albany for about, say, 22 days in a row. But I had to, come down for a day and come back up. I can't be without my family for that long. So it would say, my daughter had just been born in December of 2016. And I go right into session January of 2017. So, having a family that's supportive of my vision for the community is necessary.
That's incredible. I want to touch on that a little bit because clearly you are embracing the philosophy of allowing grandparents who are nearby to help out during this, during this upbringing. I'm very blessed to have my mom just 10 minutes in one direction, my in-laws 10 minutes in another direction. So we're just like this triangle right here. What's it like for you and your in-laws and your parents, and how much where will their involvement be until you're, back on Fridays to be allow yourself to be a little bit more involved?
Very similar. The triangle, my in-laws live in Pelham Bay.
Yeah.
My mom lives in Wakefield. My dad lives in Co-op.
Okay.
So everybody's in the same area and everybody pitches in.
Would you advise that to the young families that are starting out and figuring out where they're going to be? If they're thinking about starting a family.
Yes, absolutely. Think about it. I would say there's no perfect time to do anything. Okay. I'd say that the time is right when the time is right to do anything, right? But if you can have your family in a position or close friends in a position where they're able to assist you, because no matter how much we try to go at it alone, mm-hmm. we all need somebody to help us.
Yeah.
And like, for example, today after our podcast, I'm going to go pick up my daughter.
Yeah.
But after that, I'm going to be able to drop her off at my mother-in-law's house because she understands that I'm going to have to get other work done.
Uh-huh.
I still have to come back to work and serve and do the people's business. But I'm able to take some time and you know, enjoy the time that I have, because, you know, I've been taught a lot of life lessons by my parents and my grandparents. But my grandfather once told me, you can get money back. Sometimes it doesn't seem like it. You can get material objects back, but you never get time back.
I've been blessed to visit the community members of your church. And it's clear that there's a very tight-knit support system built in there. What does that mean for you and your wife to have not only just your family, but do you have any particular parenting approaches or principles that you two share? Because it requires a lot of communication, being having to travel so much for your work, especially as an elected.
It's communication has to be ongoing and responsive and evolving. You know, our philosophies are generally the same, right? We want our children to explore things. We want to allow our children's creativity to be able to manifest itself. But you also want structure, right?
Yeah.
You also have to make sure you have a certain bedtime. You have to make sure that they do their chores and they understand the value of a dollar. And they understand that you have to brush your teeth. Mm-hmm. And you have to take a bath. And you have to do these things. Do what you have to do now so you can do what you want to do later. And, you know, teaching our kids that, you know, reward system sooner rather than later is better. If you do the right thing, mm-hmm. then you will get good things. If you don't do the right thing, then you don't.
So it's so you're promoting more of the just like a reward system. Just good things equal, like, what you put into it is what you're going to get out of it.
Correct. And you all, but we also promote understanding that you live in a community and understand that everything that you do matters, and that just because you have something doesn't mean that everybody else has something. So you have to do better at understanding people. Yeah. And my daughter recently, at my oldest, asked me about September 11th. You know, it was on the news on 9/11, and I was taking her to school, and she was asking me what 9/11 was. And some of those are hard conversations to a 5-year-old, no matter how intelligent she may be. And I had to break it down. I said, something bad happened, but we have better people to get us through it. And I think sometimes, you know, I'm still learning along the way as far as what parenting is. And Dr. Robert Smith is a local Co-op City resident, and I have to give him credit for this, because I've heard him say this on a couple of occasions. Okay. He might have gotten from somewhere else, but I'm gonna give him credit. Parenting, fatherhood specifically, is the only job that you get that you're innately not qualified for when you get the job. But along the way, you learn tips, you learn tricks, you figure it out, and you're all the better for it. And ultimately, what I want my kids to be able to say is that, Dad, you tried your best with us. You taught us values. You taught us morals. And you taught us how a man should treat women.
Fantastic. Moving on to a little bit of the practical, everyday after school stuff. Are your children participating in any after school activities yet, like a dance or music or even church-based programs? What age are you and your wife involving your daughters into extracurricular activities, for example?
Well, we're in the process of looking at a couple of dance places. We've had them in swim classes before.
Yeah.
Just trying to allow them to have different systems of socialization, right?
Yeah.
You know, you have your class friends, you have your cousins, but you can have your camp friends, you can have your swimming class friends.
That's right.
And you understand people differently, and you understand how to interact with different groups of people. So we're in the process of figuring out what we're going to do with them, whether it's going to be dance or swim. But right now, you know, her transition to kindergarten, you know, it's been a rough one for her. You know, it's a new environment. You know, she's used to going, you know, to one place, and she misses her pre-K friends. So it's sometimes it's better after school. We take her to my mother-in-law, and she gets to hang out with her sister.
Oh, yeah.
And then, you know, nothing. She's always talking about, as soon as I pick her up, she wants two things. She wants an icy, of course.
Of course.
And she wants to go make sure she knows what Karina's doing. So.
Oh my gosh. I love watching that sibling bond in my own children. Our daughter, we got her started similarly at 4 or 5. We had her doing swim, and slowly but surely wanted to have her in some kind of martial arts program. So we ended up choosing karate. One of my friends, actually, during medical school, him and his wife started a coding school. So they're expanding, and can't wait to share more about that. It's been a pleasure speaking so far, but for the education segment, to all of our listeners, we are you are listening to the Notagro podcast, Parenting While Legislating. We'll be right back after this short break. For my brothers with daughters, I call this, not saying that our sons are less important. For my brothers with daughters, I call this. For my brothers with daughters, I call this, not saying that our sons are less important. Hello and welcome back to the Notagro podcast. You are joined by Senator Jamaal Bailey for our conversation on parenting while legislating. Senator Bailey, thank you so much. It's been really amazing to hear about your approaches to parenting your young daughters and some of the approaches you take as a husband and wife. Take us back a little bit to your early days in college. I mean, we had a chance to go to high school together, and you went off to University of Albany. And by senior year in college, you had realized more about your passion for elected office and public service, and you became involved in politics. Tell us a little about that journey and some of the growth you've enjoyed along the way.
So, I've long, as a person of faith, I've long ago stopped believing in coincidence. I think that things happen for a reason. And I was a communications major, and I was just looking for something that I could involve myself in that involved the community. And there was a an internship that allowed you to get 15 credits, a full semester's worth of credits, and you got paid. So that was a double jackpot.
Mm-hmm.
And the best part about it was that I'd be able to do something working with government. Mm-hmm. So, when you apply to these internships, the larger ones, you don't know where you're going to be placed. But they asked you if you have a preference. And I had, I put Assemblyman Carl Hasey because it was the district that I was from. And I had heard of the Assemblyman, and I'd seen him do some good work. And I had the fortune of being able to be placed in his office. And I'll never forget the first day I go into to the office, and I walked in. And I was very nervous, and I walked in. I said, hi, Mr. Hasey. I'm Jamaal Bailey. Can I get you some coffee or something like that? He said, my name's Carl. I'm grown. I can get coffee myself. You're here to learn.
Fantastic.
And from then on, now Speaker Hasty, he's been a huge influence in my life, like a big brother to me. He's always, during that internship, I was allowed to do things places I didn't see other interns. I went to conference sometimes, and I want to shout out Wayne Jackson, the sergeant at arms for the assembly. Wayne always looked out for me as well. I went to committee meetings, I went to hearings, I went to so many different things that allowed me to really get involved and immerse myself in the legislative process, as opposed to being there just to be there.
Of course.
He allowed me to research and do the drafting of a bill. I still remember that number 89534, an act to amend the public health law relating to nicotine flavored water. Right, like these are things that you don't forget because you're allowed to do.
Incredible.
When you're allowed to get experience, just an opportunity, how amazingly you can grow.
I can't believe there was almost nicotine-flavored water. It's like, well, what the?
So here's the thing, right? Nickel water was a smoking cessation product.
Okay.
And so much like the patch.
Or the gum.
Right? Patch or the gum. It was sold, but it didn't fall under the same regulations that all the other products did. So you can be any age and buy that,
and
as
you
opposed
can get hooked
to
the water.
Correct. And so as opposed to having to be 18 at the time to purchase a cigarette. Mm-hmm. Now it's 21. Then there was no regulation. You can go into a local Rite Aid or a Walgreens or a Kroger's or whatever place you wanted to go to. And if nickel water was available, it doesn't matter how old you were, you'd be able to buy it. And we did research. There was a bill in Maine. Westchester County had a bill that did that. And I did the research along with my supervisor, Paul, and we were able to put it together. And wow. The assembly passed the bill.
So you're in your early to mid-20s, and you're getting experiences that your peers who just recently graduated college and starting their first full-time jobs, they're not getting these types of hands-on opportunities that you are, thanks to your boss.
Yes.
Take us through some of the other growth that you enjoyed. I mean, and any advice for others who have this type of fortune to get this amazing match?
Don't take it for granted. I would simply say take every single day as if it could be the last day that you're working, right? you've got to put every ounce of effort that you possibly have into your work, because you never know when things are going to come up. To be honest with you, I didn't see myself running for office. I just wanted to be involved. I cared about my community. I wanted to do good things, and I wanted to do good work for people. I just wanted to be involved. And working for somebody like Speaker Hasty, like somebody that takes the people very seriously, but is not a dictator, is not somebody who does not, he wants to give you autonomy because he wants the next generation to succeed. If you have an internship, do what everybody else isn't doing. How can you make yourself indispensable? How can you work harder than anybody else's? Because at the end of the day, when you're waking up, how many other people are trying to beat you at what you're doing?
Can you give us a few examples of things that you actually did yourself?
I mean, researching legislation.
Compared to your peers, yeah, go on.
Researching legislation, being able to have, in my office now, I have a pen certificate, a copy of that legislation that we were able to pass, co-authoring the budget equity book back when we had our Republican governor, not to make this about party, but when Governor Pataki was the governor, the Black, Puerto Rican, Hispanic, and Asian Legislative Caucus, they put out and still put out a book called Budget Equity. How can we make the budget more equitable? I authored the higher education portion of the budget equity book. These are things that I don't forget. This was in 2004. And I can remember like it was yesterday because it had that much of an impact. Being able to be given that freedom.
You had just graduated college then.
I hadn't even graduated.
You hadn't even graduated.
I was a senior.
I was like, wait a minute. Wait a minute. This timeline is too familiar.
I was a senior in college and it was my final semester. And I was getting all of this practical experience that many of my colleagues and many of my friends got as interns, right? They got those. They got it as well. But I'm forever blessed to have had such an opportunity, which is why sometimes it gets crowded in here, but I'd like to have a lot of interns in here as well. I want to pay it forward, and I want them to do things that are meaningful, not just to the office.
You heard that, to our listeners? I end every episode with pay it forward.
Pay it forward.
Every single episode. So tell us about the 36th Senate District in New York State, your vision for this amazing district. We went to high school in this district or right next door? Like, is this in our Senate district?
It is a block out.
A block out. It is a block out. Okay.
It is a block out. Senator Alessandro Biaggi has the great honor of representing the Bronx High School of Science.
Okay.
And Clinton. It's a block out. It's across the street from so Scott Towers and Clinton and Tracy Towers, across the street from Clinton and Bronx Science respectively.
So the food truck and the other truck and the other truck are all in different Senate blocks.
Well, actually,
The other truck, the food truck, and there's the other truck.
The Kenny's food truck was squarely in Senator Biaggi's district.
Okay.
And the other truck, the breakfast truck around the corner, you know, depending on where you park, sometimes he might have been in my district, he might have been in Alessandra's.
A lot of changes happening in the Bronx right now. What's your vision for 36?
Just, we want more jobs for people. More opportunity for people, greater opportunities for education, more education funding in the state budget. We want to make sure that we continue to reform an unjust, historically unjust criminal justice system. But at the end of the day, what people want, everybody across each of the 63 Senate districts, everybody generally wants the same thing. And I don't think it's any different. You want good jobs.
Jobs.
You want safety.
Yep.
And you want opportunity. You want good education for your kids. Those are the things that you want. Right. And also those are the things that we're trying to provide through not just legislation, but community activism and advocacy. Because what happens is this, right? When you know your neighbor, you're going to look out for your neighbor more. So my neighbors, the McDaniel family, anytime my wife and I, my family, we leave, the McDaniels watch out for us. And they'll let us know if there's something that, you know, they don't think is right in the neighborhood. Thankfully, we live in a nice area, but nothing really happens there. But they let us know if there's anything with the inkling of suspicion. If you know your neighbor's more likely to look out for you. So that's why we do so many community buildings. I want to make sure I plug my staff. My staff is incredible.
Yeah.
I mentioned earlier that I'm in Albany January through June, 3 to 5 days out of the week.
Yeah.
The people who are holding it down, constituent services, answering phones, doing the work to keep the clock moving here, are my staff. So
shout out to the Bailey Bunch.
Shout out to the Bailey Bunch. The Bailey Bunch is great. Jason, Ashley, Jocelyn, Kenny, Rennell, Nancy, Isaac, Leslie, Unique. Up in Albany, we got Osal is here as well. Bryce is in Vanderbilt. We had a summer youth student who was so good. We kept them on staff. We have Ashton and Bianca up in Albany. We have Jackie, Noel, and Rachel. We're just the whole bunch, man. I'm blessed to work with great people who take my mission seriously because this is home for me. I grew up a few blocks away from here on Paulding Avenue. I remember when the Dunkin' Donuts and everything across the street was a Wonder Bread store, and I used to come over here and get fruit pies and things like that.
How far was that from the church? Because I remember making the turn on Paulding to head to the church.
I grew up three blocks away from the church.
It was a really fun time. It was a really fun time with amazing food, amazing performances. The bunch was there, and it was just a fun time to get to learn more about this community. Any particular goals you're looking to champion for District 36 in the upcoming session before we hit up the culture section?
Well, I mean, we want to make sure we're doing some things around policing, making sure that we have transparency. I want to be very clear. I respect the job that our men and women in blue. Shout out to the NYPD. They do work that other people don't want to do.
Yep.
You know, they run into danger when we're running away. But there's got to be a better community relations divide in the commanding inspectors that patrol the districts that I represent. They're phenomenal people, and they understand the mission that I'm trying to do, trying to make it more fair in our justice system and with policing. Economic development is going to be big this session, I think.
Okay.
Making sure that we're doing more in terms of job creation.
Great.
More housing, more affordable housing, so that people can actually afford to... So it's not just a novel concept that you're able to actually eat and live somewhere, right? You want to create good career track jobs for people. Those are things that I want to do for the folks in my district, and also instill a sense of pride in the 36. Like, I want people to believe that, even though I believe that we have 63 great districts, I've got to think my district's the best.
Before we head to the culture section, you got to tell me all the puns and references that go through your head every time you say the 36, because you got the 36 woo, the 36 chambers. So how much of that album goes through your mind every time you're talking about the district?
Last year, a good friend of mine, when I turned 36 and represented the 36, so he put up something on Facebook and said I was entering a 36 chamber. And sometimes I do a hashtag on my social media, enter the 36th. Hip hop is a big part of who I am, and so like I try to infuse that into whatever I can do in with the district. But it's a great district.
No other non-36-year-old can co-opt that. That you get to keep it as long as you have the seat.
Well, I mean, I'm 37 now, but, you know...
You get to keep it forever, because you're in 36,
I'll forever be in the 36th chamber. That's what we like to call it.
You clearly have a lot of passion for mentorship. You benefited from some amazing mentors from your childhood and your folks, to your church leaders, to Speaker Heastie. And, it's clear to me as a fellow dad that you're passing a lot of those values upon your amazing girls and now the rest of the 36th. So on that note, we'll take a short break and we'll be back for our final segment, the culture section. With the Glock running up in your spot. But if it wasn't for the Bronx, this rap shit probably never would be going on. So tell me where you from. Uptown, baby. Uptown, baby. We gets down, baby. Up for the crown, baby. Now if it wasn't for the Bronx, this rap shit probably never would be going on. So tell me where you from. Uptown, baby. Uptown, baby. We gets down, baby. Up for the crown. Hello and welcome back to the Notre Girl podcast. We are joined by Senator Jamaal Bailey for the episode Parenting While Legislating. We've arrived to our favorite section, the culture segment. So for those of you just tuning in, Senator Bailey and I graduated high school in the late 90s, early 2000s, just 1 year apart. He's a Bronx raised, born and raised dude. I'm a Queens raised guy. And we both have children in our lives. So raising kids, the episode's on parenting. Let's talk a little about sports and arts. What type of sports are you thinking about for your daughters, if they've shown any inclination, or arts that they've shown inclination for? I got a girl and a boy, and you got karate and swim, we've already mentioned, some coding. I think pickup basketball is not for my daughter. She's definitely not with the karate. So what's it like in the Bailey household?
Well, I mean, my daughter's children will react to what they see sometimes.
Yeah.
And my children so far, knock on wood, they seem like they're taking to the Mets and the Knicks. From time to time, if you're walking under a doorway in my household, my children might try to dunk on you in the doorway.
Fantastic.
So they are taking to basketball quite nicely, basketball and baseball, soccer as well. I never played soccer growing up, so I don't have a nexus of expertise, but I'm be more than happy to put them in a soccer program if that's what they want to play. But most importantly, they have to do something active.
Yeah.
Whether they I shouldn't say whether they like it or not. I don't mean yeah. like that. But whether they enjoy the sport or not. Sports for me were...
What did you do?
I ran track. I played baseball. I played basketball on what I still believe is Bronx Science's best basketball team ever. We got to the city quarterfinals. And to this day, we should have won a city championship.
Your senior year? So spring 2000. Because I graduated in 99. You guys went how far in the city?
City quarterfinals. We lost to Roosevelt at Lehman College. I didn't want to go back to Lehman College for a long time after we lost that game.
You played the three on the team? What did you play?
I played the three. I was an undersized three. We had Jaquan. Shout out to Jaquan.
Yeah, you got to shout out the whole team right now. Come on.
Shout out to Jaquan and Mackie, Kahende, Jermaine, Imhotep, Jules, Jaquan.
I saw Imhotep's dad at Simonson High School. He was there. Really? He's like, oh, you went to Bronx Science? Yeah, I'm Imhotep's dad. I was like, oh, snaps.
It was David Bang. Greg Francis, the whole team. We were, it was a great opportunity because we got to smash a couple of myths that just because you went to Bronx Science, that didn't mean you couldn't hoop, right?
Yeah.
And we got all the way to the city quarterfinals, and we lost to Roosevelt. Roosevelt had a kid named Ed Berrios who went on to play D1 ball. Sammy Mejia, who went to play for DePaul, actually got a cup of coffee with the Detroit Pistons as well.
Wow.
And they beat us that day, but we should have beat them because we beat them during the regular season. And we went 1-1. They beat us at Roosevelt. We beat them at Science. And to this day, I won't forget game.
You can't go back to Lehman easy. It's not easy for us.
I actually just came from Lehman College. I had a ribbon cutting from the Performing Arts Center.
You couldn't
kick the memory. But still, it was a formative experience in sports such that, I was okay at basketball. I was never going professional in anything. But sports for me were more about team building and understanding that no matter what, no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what you're doing, you don't win by yourself.
Yeah.
Winning takes a team concept. If we can get to professional basketball later, James Harden, the way he plays basketball, very talented, he's going to get you all the buckets in the world, but can he get you a championship with that style of play?
No.
I don't know.
Especially not with Russ holding the ball this year.
Not with D'Antoni coaching either.
That's right. So take us forward. I know some of the legislators upstate unwind with some pickup sports. If you want to drop some names, now's the time to do it. If you want to talk some trash, tell us about the legislative pickup basketball games of the New York State Senate and Assembly.
Oh, it is quite fun. So on Tuesday night, sometimes when we go to the 3-day sessions, the State Police Academy, they're kind enough to allow us to use their facilities on Tuesday nights. And we have legislative runs, and we don't have organized teams. It's kind of who gets there, but some of the people that frequent there are Assemblyman Brian Barnwell out of Queens, Clyde Vanell, Ed Braunstein. It's a big Queens contingent. Ron Kim, Patrick Gallivan, Senator Patrick Gallivan, a senator from upstate New York. Pat Gallivan, Pat's got game.
So how do you guys pick the team? Is it like Queens versus the rest, or is it like you just guys like the first seed to hit, and then you guys pick up that way?
We just kind of either shoot for teams or shoot for captains. And shout out to Robert Jackson. RJ comes through.
Yeah, he comes through.
Robert Jackson is probably in the best shape of any senator. Well, John Liu also, but I still haven't gotten John. John, if you're listening, John, I need you to come out to play ball with us next year, John. Come
Senator
on.
Liu, Senator Jackson, Senator Way,
Senator Myrie. That's
I know he's a sneakerhead. We sometimes message each other about sneaker culture. Is he a hooper too?
Oh, he's a hooper. Yeah, Zeke can ball.
Who got the best jump shot?
Depends, man.
Oh, you gotta say it. We gotta drop names. Who got the best jump shot? Who got the best handles and best defense? I'll ask those two questions.
It might be the best jumper.
And don't say you got all three. It's like, oh no, Bailey.
No, that's like dial on. No, but the best defensive player is definitely not me. That might be Might be my chief of staff. It might be Jason. Okay. Jason Ball's up there. He plays some.
So we got the staff involved, and we got. So your teammate is one of the best defenders. Any of the other names out there who got the jump shot and handles?
Ron Kim is really strong. Clive
Vanell. He played football. I'm like, he's going to college. Ron Kim.
Clive Vanell has a great jump shot too. Brian Barnwell is your consummate point guard. He's a floor leader. Speaker Hasty can ball too. Joe Robach, Senator Joe Robach. So it's bipartisan up there, man. You know, Tuesday nights, there's no party. We just Republicans, Democrats.
It's all love on the court.
We just get out there and ball. Best handle,
It looks like it's Senator Bailey. He's listening to Kendra and keeping it humble. So since we're on basketball, you know, you clearly play. You're very, very familiar with the game. I grew up a Scotty fan, so I was a big-time Nick hater until, like, college when my roommate in Harlem, we lived in Harlem for 5 years, and he was watching all the Nick games. So Howard Eisley, Shannon Anderson, Michael Doliak, Clarence Weatherspoon, Michael Sweetney. If you haven't had indigestion yet, that's when I started messing with the Knicks.
Yes.
So we talked about the free agency coming up before it happened. Do you have inside sources of the Knicks? Is there anything this New York State Senate can do to save the Knicks, first of all? And what are your goals as a Knicks fan and as an overall NBA fan? Let's take it to the New York culture.
We can keep on pushing. I don't think there's anything in our legislative powers that can compel the New York Knicks to compel free agents to sign with the New York Knicks. I wish we did have a law that we made sure that certain free agents that resided within a certain geographical area of a city of a million people or more had to sign with the New York State with the New York Knicks.
Yeah.
But Brooklyn Nets, as much as I hate to say it, that's my dad's team, and I really don't like the Nets, but they're looking really solid. Got a lot of good pieces this year.
Are there a lot of Bronx residents that are Net fans? Like, how is the Net fandom up in the Bronx? Not from Queens, and we're like, yeah, we know the Knicks. Very few Net fans from Queens, but what's it like in the Bronx for you guys?
Not really. Like, the only Net fans I really know are my dad and my uncle, right? These guys, and they were Net fans when they were in New Jersey and in Long Island when it comes down to guys like Super John Williamson and Dr. J and those folks, right? Goes back to the Nets from then. So he's not necessarily a New Jersey Net fan.
The first Net game at Barclays where the Knicks are playing, they're giving out 10,000 Kyrie replica jerseys out of fear that the Knicks fans are going to roll deep with the Mason jerseys or the Ewing jerseys or, you know, Archie Barrett. So who are you excited about for this season in the Knicks basketball, even though you can't sway the free agent, Senator Bailey?
I'm very excited about the Knicks season.
Me too.
Like, it might not have been a lot of flash, but this team is going to be like that Doc Rivers team. And Doc Rivers won the Coach of the Year in Orlando. I think they went 40.
You serious? When
they
went 2000 Magic?
I think they went 42 and 40. Me? And it's just a team with a lot of grit, a lot of heart, a lot of hustle. You got guys like Bobby Portis and Elfrid Payton and Wayne Ellington. These guys, Julius Randle, these guys.
But do we have a Darryl Armstrong to take us? And has Fizdale shown the chops? As you're going to run into Fizdale, I'm sure. So how can we see Fizdale reach the Coach Rivers level?
I think Fizz can do it, man. I think that when you can reach the players, and I think that's what makes Doc Rivers such a good coach.
Yeah,
that he can get in touch with the players because he was a former player.
Mm-hmm.
He understands the game, and he understands what players are thinking. And I think Fizz, you know, folks have spoken about him and back in Miami, and you know, if he's good enough for Bron and D Wade, I think he's good enough for the Garden.
We don't got the talent like Bron and D Wade in their prime was. Like, so we got RJ and Kevin Knox. They just both signed with Puma. You want to take it to sneakers? You want to take it to music for the final segment? We could do both. So what are you rocking in your footwear nowadays? For the YouTube heads, I had to make sure to pop out the Ewings.
For
a senator, because you know when you're a minority kid, you can't afford the Nikes and the Reeboks, which are like top. Then it was Nike. You had to try British Ewings Knights, and then you got the Ewings.
Oh, the Ewings were it. This is a majority Caribbean, heavily Jamaican population. So the Ewings were it in this district. Those were some of the major sneakers. But I love sneakers. I got a. Picked up a pair of Vapor Maxes like last week.
Which color? I got
really comfortable. Reddish and black ones.
Okay.
Incredibly comfortable. Picked up some the threes, the Knicks threes that came
the
out.
The Knicks threes?
The Knicks threes that
I
came was, out.
I got the Vapor Max and the neon yellow because of the podcast. Podcast colors. I was trying to get some more podcast like neon stuff. I got the Puma bag over there.
But now that you said so, I got to go back for the threes. I was like, Mike keeps taking our money, though. Mike is like always like this color, that color.
And that's the thing, right? You know, but for me, sneakers are sometimes the price tag might be a bit much for them.
And
I would say to anybody out there, don't go above what you can afford. I can't get every new release because I have responsibility to take care of. But sneakers for me, sneaker culture is so important to me because I didn't grow up in a family that had a car for a long time. So sneakers for me, that was my limousine, right?
Yeah.
Sneakers for me,
made
sneaker, a lot of my friends, that was our way of being able to show, that was our Benz, that
we
was
didn't our have, BMW. We didn't have houses, we didn't have fancy cars, so like the sneaker or like something like that was like the closest thing we could have.
And it's really hard because you don't want your kids to be raised on, you know, falling in love with material objects. KRS-One famously said, love's going to get you. It's going to get you, right? When you love that car and you love that sneaker. But still, like, what that sneaker represented to me was something that I appreciated. And, you know, and sneaker culture is still a part of who I am to this day, man.
What are the girls rocking in the house?
Well, they get... What do they have now? What
am I doing? You're surely involved in it with their mom, but
we got them a couple of pair of Jordans earlier on, some 11, some Concord action.
Concord they for got, girls, yeah.
They have some Pumas now with the kid fit with the sole.
Yeah.
Incredibly comfortable for them. So for younger kids, it's not so much about styling so much as it is about comfort
and ability to put it on in the morning and not take 10 minutes to leave the house.
Yes, I got my oldest pair of Jordan 1s for her birthday, which was just Saturday.
Oh yeah,
you know, she her favorite color is teal, and we were at an outlet store, and she saw some Jordans. She's like, Dad, I like those. I'm like, oh, I don't know about right now, but as soon as she left the store, my wife ran back.
I'm saving them, get a size extra for a few months later for Christmas time.
And they grow so fast.
Oh my gosh, I'll tell you, we had all the Jordans in the house, maybe two sneakers per year because their feet grow so fast. But one of my friends, he's a sneaker, he put me at the Vans for the kids.
Yes, they have some.
So
shout out to my brother-in-law too. My brother-in-law works with Vans.
And he's put
my wife and my daughters onto the Vans, and they love their Vans. For me,
crazy.
I don't rock them, but that's just me. I have my own likes, but for them, they like them a lot.
Try out the Puma Clydes, the green and black track. I got those. They're fire. I wouldn't do this episode justice without getting your top five, because you're a Bronx dude. I'm a Queens guy. I was at one of your parties that you threw for the whole weekend in Albany, and you guys were dropping the Lord Tariq Peter Guns Uptown, baby.
Yes,
and
sir.
It was going nuts. A lot of, like, do you and Speaker Heastie mess on that? Because you had all the Peter Guns parts down. He came in to the dance for the Lord Tariq part. So take us through Mount Rushmore of hip-hop artists.
Oh, man, that's hard, man. So, like, Biggie, Jay-Z, and Nas, if you grew up, when we grew up in New York.
That's what Jay Clark said.
You've got to, that's like the holy trinity of MCs, right? And so you round out the two, right? Like, where do you go? Do you go Rakim and Slick Rick? MC Ricky D from, right? Slick Rick was not too far from here,
but
right?
Do Bronx guys recognize Rakim? Because he's from, like, Long Island. And, like,
enough to break New York from Long Island. You got to recognize the R, man. Okay, nobody beats the R, man.
Oh, he's making the list. He's making, you got to round it out for the top five.
And that's, you know, I might have to go Pun, man.
You have to.
I might have to go Pun.
You got
to
go Pun.
Dead in the middle of literally, you know, like, you got to go. I got to go BX, man. But KRS-One, like, how do I leave KRS off the list?
You can't. I mean, KRS is probably, like, a pioneer. He's got his own special category of, like, the people who you could not go up against. Like, KRS, Rakim, some folks consider Nas in that conversation. Eminem, you just don't want to go against them and get destroyed. But Senator Bailey, hopefully this is the first of many conversations. It's been a pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Best of luck to our New York Knicks.
Yes.
Best of luck to the Mets, orange and blue, all day, every day, till this day.
Let's go.
To everyone tuning in, thank you so much for joining the Know to Grow podcast. Clearly, we had a lot of topics we got to cover today, from parenting to mentorship to community empowerment. Tune in for future shows and check us out on all our... Where can we find you on the follows? IG, if you want to plug any of your pages, anything where we can follow you before we send off our pay it forward message.
So you can find me on Twitter at Jamaal T. Bailey. My parents named me a little different, so it's JamaalTBaileY. On IG, it's JamaalTBaileY36 at the end. And on Facebook, it's Jamaal T. Bailey, JamaalTBaileY. Those are the, I'm too old for Snapchat. I don't even try that, so I don't have that. I don't know what that is.
And to all the listeners, this should probably be episode 7. We just dropped 5 episodes last week. Okay. We're building it. Now we're dropping them one by one. Catch us on, what, Notre Girl Pod on IG? Is that what it is? Notre Girl Pod on IG, on Instagram. We're on iTunes Podcasts. We're on Spotify. We're on Stitcher. For if you're on iTunes Podcast, please give us the 5 stars and hit us up in the comments if you want to see any updates and changes, any feedback. If you want to be on the show and talk about a particular topic. Until next time, please remember to pay it forward. Pay it forward, folks, and thank you for joining.